So the most successful commercial microlithic product since many years and still is the printhead, inkjet printheads. So what are inkjet printheads? Inkjet printheads are the heads of printers that shoot little droplets of ink from the printhead onto a piece of paper. And it does that in a controlled way. So if you shoot the right amount of droplets in the right position, basically you're printing out a text or a picture you do it in color. And this is the way that inkjet printers work. So it makes also sense to look actually how this is done in practice. There are three main types of inkjet printheads. So we have laser printers. I'm not going to talk about that. I even don't know how they work. But in microfluidics, you use inkjet printheads. And typically what you have is a nozzle system. So we have a microfluidic nozzle and an ink reservoir. And that ink reservoir and nozzle is going to be able to shoot out droplets. And they're shot towards a piece of paper that is moving at its velocity u here. So the paper is moving, and then you shoot droplets or you don't shoot droplets on it. And this is your ink reservoir, and this is what you call the nozzle. It's a small op the nozzle is a small opening to which you can shoot the droplets. And the first system, or one of the, you shoot several droplets, of course, and they will fall and they will land here, and then either you have like printed something or you have nothing printed. So this will be black and this will be white. Yeah. The first system of doing a print is actually the following. You put a electrode here, and I put a voltage difference here, a control voltage, signal. I'm not going to write voltage, it's a signal, voltage signal. And so now I charge my droplets, and as they fly by, I can choose to either electrostatically deflect them or not deflect them. And then here I will put a little gutter. This goes back to waste or to the ink reservoir. So if I put a voltage signal here, so I generate my droplets here, one after the other. If I put a voltage difference here, for example, this is positively charged, and if I put a negative charge here, this droplet will be deflected away and move end up here on the waste gutter. If I don't put a signal, this is just a positively charged droplet that will move straight ahead. If I don't put a signal, it will just move straight ahead and hit the paper. So basically, most of the droplets I'm going to deflect away into a waste gutter, and then this goes to waste and probably back to the ink reservoir. And only when I want to have a droplet, I don't put a signal and the droplet goes straight and hits the paper. Yeah, this is continuous droplet printing. The second type of system uses, by the way, this continuous droplet printing very typically uses a piezoelectric element that sits here on a diaphragm. Piezo element that vibrates very fast, so you generate very fast every these pressure pulses that are shot out. So this is continuous printing. The next type of printing is a drop-on-demand printing. I'm still going to use a piezo, but not. I'm not going to vibrate it constantly. I'm only going to vibrate it exactly when I want to have a droplet. So I don't need a waste anymore. I just have my paper running, and when I know, okay, I need a droplet here because I need to print something, then it's just going to give a hit, and that's going to shoot out the droplet, and the drop is going to fly to the paper. And when it doesn't want it, it's not going to do that. And the third way of main way of doing it is also drop on demand. Instead of having a piezo element here, we're going to have a nozzle that's slightly longer here and with an opening here. And in that nozzle, we're going to put a heater element. This is called a bubble jet printer. Yeah. So what's happening here is that if I want to generate a bubble, I'm going to heat the heater. And what's happening is that the oil very locally will boil. So I'm going to have a very tiny gauze layer here. And it's going to grow to a bubble of this size. So I'm going to make a gauze bubble here. And this gauze bubble is pressing the ink. Of course, it can't press to this side because it's incompressible. So it presses the ink out on this side. And I will start having a bubble ejected. And actually, this bubble looks something typically something like this. I know printers, basically, it's not just a bullet that comes out. It's like a bullet with a long tail that comes out. And then the tail either disappears or doesn't disappear. And then, so you shoot, shoot, shoot. And then each time you get a droplet out. So if I create a bubble, the bubble shoots, and then I can cool down, the bubble collapses, system cools down, and sucks back. Just to give you some idea, in this, because these are very complex systems. You heat the heater typically to some 400 degrees Celsius, and the pressure you generate when the bubble collapses is easily 100 atmosphere. So that's the same as in a diesel engine when you have the explosion. So the surface tension creates extremely high pressure. So you have really explosive outshooting of droplets and explosive also collapse of the droplets. It's also pretty hot. And so this is a way, so you shoot droplets one by one and the paper flows. And so in that way you shoot your droplets. Of course, you don't have in a printhead, you don't have one nozzle. You have several. So out of plane, this is only one, but you have then a second and a third and a fourth out of plane. And typically you have 256 or 512 of these nozzles next to each other and shooting droplets, you know, and as the paper comes, so you write rows of text, rows of droplets at the same time. Okay. And so these are actually very well thought through systems and very complex systems. All of this these are actually little chips. These systems are little chips and they're integrated into the ink cartridge, and that's the disposable that you buy and that you put into your inkjet printer. That the top unit of that is this one here. And basically if you have 512 of these little heaters here, I need 512 control signals for those heaters. But if I have a little cartridge, if you look at it, there's not 512 little wires sticking out for control signals. So I have an entire electronic system built into this one. So basically what happens here is that I have a serial, my information flow from my printer to my printhead comes in serial. So I just have a two line in telling me, or a few lines, not many anyway. So you have a voltage source, of course, and then you have your serial data line. And the serial data is locally on-site, you have a serial to parallel conversion of your signal, and actually you can see that in your slides here. This is very nicely. So you have your serial data in, you get a serial to parallel conversion of your signal. Sorry, we are here, and this is so difficult for me to see. I have to work upside down. So your serial data comes in. It's converted to an analog to a parallel signal for all the 512 channels, and each of these signal lines is then amplified locally, because the signal here, the TCL signal, the electronic signal, is not strong enough to fire the heater. You need an amplifier on board, and then you shoot out a droplet, and at the same time, it measures. There's also a sensing system where you measure the pressure, the temperature, whether you get enough flow, and so on. And all that measuring data is then sent back to the computer. So this entire logic circuitry is built in into the same device, into the same chip as your printhead. So here you can see how such a chip looks like. So you have your data lines in. You have all your logic here in the CMOS. In your electronics, then you have your amplifiers, and then here between the amplifiers you have your little droplets that can shoot out. There's an opening here, so, and that is an entire electronic fluidic system entirely integrated. Huh? So very, very complex systems, but because they have such a high throughput and they're sold in such high quantities, they can be made very cheap anyway. Time for a quiz about this bubble jet principle that I've just shown here. It's also shown actually in your PDF file, so you can find it there. But my quiz question is the following, actually. Something is going to limit, some of the parameters are going to limit how fast I can print here. And my question is for you to think, which of these points will be actually limiting the amount of pages per minute that a bubble jet printer can print? Is it the maximum amount of parallel nozzles, or is it the maximum feed rate of the paper, or is it the maximum speed at which the droplets can fly through the air, or is it the temperature in the printhead, or the maximum speed at which a gas bubble can be formed, or the maximum speed at which a gas bubble can collapse, or the capillary filling of the printhead channels? After firing, it needs to refill the channel. So which of these do you think will be the limiting factor? Think about it and click the ones that you think are correct.
So let's have a look at them now. The maximum amount of parallel nozzles in a printhead, of course, that will be a limiting factor. If I every time I double that, I will have double the speed. So that's for sure. The maximum feeding speed of the paper? Nah, not so much, because it's not difficult to really speed up paper a lot. It's really the printing itself, the shooting of the droplets, that will be the speed limit, not the speed of the paper. So is it the maximum speed to which the droplets can fly through the air? No, not at all. That has nothing to do with it. In practice, the droplet speed is typically 10 meters per second. But even if it were 1 meter per second, it doesn't matter. As long as it's synchronized with the paper movement, it doesn't matter how fast they actually fly. Huh? The temperature in the printhead? Yeah, sometimes, but normally not. But sometimes it does. So what happens is that, of course, if you have a system like this, I have this heater that is firing 400 degrees, fire, 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 fire. The system starts heating up. And it has to, you know, between different firing cycles, it has to cool down to allow for the liquid, for the bubble to collapse. But if I have a channel here and next here, I have another channel. So if I'm in the middle, so if I have three channels next to each other and these two are firing all the time, the middle one will start being heated up because of the heat flux. So there's a chance for crosstalk, heat crosstalk between those. So if I fire these constantly, there's a chance that the middle one also starts firing. I don't want it to, but because the heat flux is so high that also the middle one starts generating bubbles. So I need to sometimes, if you fire too much on one point, you may need to slow down partly, because otherwise you're going to have heat flux. But that doesn't happen too often. But sometimes it's a problem, the temperature. The maximum speed at which the gas bubble can be formed? No, that is not a limit, because heating up something is very easy. Just the more power you give, the faster you heat it. So that's really not the limiting factor. The cooling? Yeah, you might think, because the cooling you need to collapse, but in practice it's actually not. The main limiting factor, and maybe that's surprising, but that's the last one, is the capillary refill of the printhead channels. And you can see that here. If my bubble is going to shoot out this droplet here, so this droplet disappears here, and then my liquid from this here. Now this bubble is collapsing, it will suck back this amount of liquid. So we'll end up in a situation where this droplet has disappeared here and that volume is gone here. So I have a droplet that looks like this. Now this channel will need to refill to this position again until it's here. And it's actually that refill that will be the limiting factor. And that refill is typically, so that will limit your droplets to maybe, I don't know how fast they go, maybe a few hundred per second or something, or 1,000, I don't know by heart. But that will be the limiting factor. The capillary refill will typically be the limiting factor.